Good morning to everybody and welcome to this webinar organized by the Foundation Euro-Mediterranean Center on Climate Change, CMCC. My name is Monia Santini, researcher here at CMCC, mostly on the topic of climate change impact on ecosystem and with a special focus on water resources. I am the moderator of this webinar, but before starting, let me say a few words about CMCC. Next slide, please. So CMCC is a non-profit research organization created in 2005 with the financial joint support of several Italian ministries. And CMCC conducts and promotes scientific activities, basic and applied research, but also consultancies related to climate change science. The particular aspect of CMCC is that it brings together multiple competencies and topics related to climate change, from coupled atmosphere and ocean dynamics to impact on the ecosystem, on the society, and on the economy. This is why CMCC became fast an institutional point of reference, both at international and national level for scientists and policymakers. Next slide, please. CMCC takes advantage of the extensive and consolidated research experience of its foundation members and institutional partner. The center is organized in the form of a network distributed across Italy with the headquarters in Lecce and other offices in Bologna, Capua, Milan, Sassari, Venice, and Viterbo, where I am now. Next slide, please. CMCC activities are organized into nine research divisions, dealing with climate dynamics and impacts at different spatial temporal scales for different sectors and exploiting multiple scientific tools, from simple approaches to very complex models, thanks also to the availability of last generation high performance computing resources. Then, CMCC, next slide, please. Is also highly active in outreach activities through scientific papers and other types of publication, social channels, organization of events, and education programs. The series of webinars also belong to these activities and reach more and more people. Today, I can see connected online for now 92 people. Next slide, please. Before introducing this webinar, I want to remember that at the end, the participants are enabled to take part to the question and answer session using the question menu provided by the GoToWebinar system. Please, when you make a question, provide your first and last name and also indicate your institution. Concerning the webinar, today this webinar is dedicated to present a multidisciplinary meeting and results related to a regional scale application to assess the cumulative impact in Adriatic marine areas, including the support to adaptation to the planning and adaptation. This is a very important topic today, as these marine areas suffer from combined impact from anthropogenic driver, anthropogenic pressure, but also from natural drivers, like, for example, climate change, that alter the different components of the system, but also the human activities. The webinar presenter is Elisa Furlan, with an education in environmental planning and policies since her master's degree, with studies conducted between Venice and Barcelona. And then her studies continued with a PhD at Ca' Foscari University in Venice. Her research focuses on the development and application of risk assessment methodologies at the multidisciplinary level, also based on multi-criteria decision analysis for the quantification and then the management on environmental risk, so to support the design, the selection, the new formulation of adaptation policies and strategies. Elisa also collaborates since 2013 with CMCC, in particular with the RAS division, And in the thanks to this collaboration with CMCC, she extended the approach, the methodologies she is developing, also considering climate change scenarios and as the importance of taking into account also the uncertainty in the future. So please, Elisa, now you can start with this webinar.
Okay, thank you, Monia. Thank you for the floor. And first of all, also thank you to the CMCC, to the Euro-Mediterranean Center for Climate Change Foundation for hosting this webinar. I really enjoyed the opportunity to share with you and all the researchers that are connected, the main finding, the resulting output of my study. Which has the title suggest, and has Monia already introduced, deal with the development and implementation of a risk-based approach for the evaluation of cumulative impacts in marine areas. So, going briefly to the outline of this presentation, first of all, I will introduce the main issues and challenges that marine planners and managers have to face in order to manage the conflicting use of the sea and the rising threats to this vulnerable area. The main objective and the related objective of the study that I'm going to present you. The multi-risk approach developed for cumulative impact appraisal. So I will focus on the methodological framework, its operative step, and then with the main resulting output of its application in the Adriatic Sea case study. Finally, I will summarize the main lesson learned obtaining from the application of the methodological approach in the case study and the future challenges that are still open for researchers in the marine science domain to carry out a more sustainable management of our marine areas. So, as we already know, our ocean and sea are facing increasing threats and degradation, which are due to the multiple and interactive pressure, endogenic and exogenic pressure, operating and acting on marine ecosystem, compromising marine ecosystem and their services for human well-being. In this already complicated scenario of multiple natural and anthropogenic pressure, climate change is posing a further complication, which is expected to exacerbate the already existing environmental impacts with the rising sea temperature, which are expected to interact, for instance, with the existing nutrient inputs, the oil spill release, leading to more severe cumulative and interactive impacts. So, on one side, marine planners and decision makers are in front of complicated challenges. So on one side, they have to define, to design and implement appropriate, spatially relevant, but more important, sustainable management strategies for the use and exploitation of marine spaces and resources. On the other side, during the design of this measure, they have always to take into account the objective of conservation and protection of marine spaces and resources, searching to achieve, restore, and maintain the famous goal posed by the Marine Strategy Framework Directive, the ambitious good environmental status of our marine areas. So, against these big challenges, it's becoming always more urgent to develop new assessment and advanced assessment approaches, which have to be integrated. So, they have to integrate and look at the all sustainable spheres. They have to be cross-sectorial in order to take into account all the potential pressure deriving from the different activities which take place on the marine areas, and have to be adaptive because they have to be robust enough to adapt and face to changes over time induced, for instance, from a climate change, from potential climate change scenario, but also due to the uncertainty leak dynamic systems such as marine area. So, if we are able to develop and get such a kind of approach, we will have a relevant decision support system to support a science-based planning and management of marine area. So, building upon this complicated scenario and complexity and challenges within this study, that is a part of my PhD research project, we develop a multi-risk approach, which allow to integrate different tools such as environmental indicators, multi-criteria decision analysis, geographic information system techniques, and Bayesian belief network to evaluate cumulative impacts in marine area. So on one side, we have environmental indicator to evaluate the vulnerability component of marine ecosystem, multi-criteria decision analysis technique to integrate heterogeneous information collected from different sources in quantitative and qualitative format. We integrate GIS-based techniques, and so we obtain a set of maps and related statistics, which allow to spatially represent and localize environmental impact for the marine system at stake. And finally, as the final ring of this a multi-tiers approach, we implement also a Bayesian network technique in order to evaluate the probability of cumulative impacts under different alternative scenario. So we can say that all these tools together act as a decision tool, providing useful information and knowledge to set priorities within the maritime spatial planning of the case study area of concern. So focusing on the design and risk-based approach, building on the, in line with the recent definition of the Intergovernmental Panel of Climate Change, we develop a multi-risk methodology based upon the three main pillars of risk. So we recognize a methodological approach that is composed of five main phases. So as a first, we recognize the multi-hazard interaction assessment, which allow to evaluate potential synergies between endogenic and exogenic pressure. Then has second phase, the exposure assessment, which allow to identify the receptor that can be threatened by the selected hazard. The vulnerability assessment, characterizing the environmental, biological, and physical vulnerability of the receptor to the selected hazard. Then the risk assessment, which integrate all the hazard, exposure, and vulnerability component. And finally, the cumulative impact assessment, which allow to get an overall picture of the cumulative impacts in the overall case study. So, in this analysis, we focus on two different climate scenarios, a baseline, which represents the current climate condition, and a future one focusing on the 2035-2015 timeframe, thus taking into account potential changes due to climate change. The methodology was applied to the, the Adriatic Sea case study, which is a semi-enclosed basin that is located in the wider Mediterranean Sea. This is a marine subregion featured by a high environmental value that is demonstrated by the localization of a relevant number of marine protected area. We can find in this basin a relevant number also of native species. But alongside this environmental value, we have also a higher economic value that is mainly linked to the fisheries activities, but also we have to remember that the Adriatic Sea, along its coast, hosts a lot of one of the most beautiful cities for touristic attraction, such as one example, Venice. So another relevant economic point is mainly related to the touristic sector. So now we can focus on the methodological approach. So as a first step of the develop methodologies, we find out the multi-hazard interaction assessment phase, which allow to aggregate metrics and scenario from climate, ocean, geochemical, and anthropogenic pressure in order to identify potentially affected marine area. This main phase is already subdivided in other operative methodological steps, which allows to select the hazard to be considering the study, define the temporal window to be considered. And for these two steps, we take into account the requirement posed by the Marine Strategy Framework Directive. So we focus on hazard listed in the Marine Strategy Framework Directive. The third phase required to analyze and spatially model the symbol pressure and then assess and spatially model the interactive behavior of this pressure acting in concert on the same target. Finally, by applying specific multi-criteria decision analysis technique, we normalize the resulting output of this step in a 0-1 range. So in order to implement the multi-hazard interaction assessment phase, we collect multiple data sets characterizing natural and anthropogenic pressure, data sets that were collected from different private and open sources data repositories, and then they were pre-processed to specific GIS functions. So based on the available data set, we selected, and according to the requirement of the Marine Strategy Framework Directive, we selected a set of six hazards linked with biological, physical, and chemical impact. So looking at this slide, we focus as a first on physical impact, including the anthropogenic introduced technological hazard that is mainly related to the localization of benthic infrastructure on the seabed, on the seabed, which leads to the smoother and sealing of the seafloor. As a second hazard, we focus on the anthropogenic extractive technological hazard, which is linked to the abrasion of the seabed due to the extraction of sands and gravel, but also to the trawling fishing activities, and finally to the anthropogenic physical hazard due to underwater noise induced by shipping traffic. Then we focus on chemical impacts, focusing on anthropogenic chronic due to nutrient inputs in the Adriatic Sea Basin and the anthropogenic acute chemical hazard due to the oil spill due to the shipping accident as a proxy. And finally, we analyze hazard, the biological hazard due to the introduction of non-indigenous species. For these three last hazards, so the anthropogenic acute and chronic chemical hazard and anthropogenic biological hazard, also according to the availability of climate scenario provided by the Euro-Mediterranean Center for Climate Change, we also evaluate the hazard score, the hazard component in a baseline scenario in the 2000-2015 timeframe and for a future scenario 2035-2050. So more specifically, for what concerns these three hazards, chemical and biological, based on a literature review and the availability of GIS data, many interactive pressure for each hazard were identified in order to model their interactive behavior in the case study. As example, for instance, for the anthropogenic biological hazard, we take into account as a pressure the introduction of non-indigenous species that the main interactive pressure which lead to this phenomena is the shipping traffic due to the ballast water, the port activity, the aquaculture and the sea surface temperature variation. But in order to model the interactive behavior between this pressure, we apply the Choquet integral as a multi-criteria decision analysis technique. The Choquet integral is a MCDA technique of the family of the weighted average model, which allows to mimic this interactive behavior by assigning a specific interaction weight to all the potential scenarios that can occur between the pressure at stake for each hazard. In order to get this coalition scenario, for the three hazards that we analyzed, chemical and biological, we defined a questionnaire which was provided to a set of marine experts in the field of environmental sciences, risk assessment, and dealing also with the maritime spatial planning. And in this questionnaire, following to a brief description of the case study area, the methodological approach, so the main component of the study, we asked them to provide an interaction way to each coalition scenario. An example in this slide of the coalition scenario for the anthropogenic biological hazard, which they take account the interaction between the variation in the sea surface temperature, the shipping traffic, the activity from ports and the aquaculture. So This is an example of the coalition scenario where zero stands for the pressure in its minimum value, so the minimum intensity of the pressure in the basin at stake. One stands for the maximum value and maximum intensity, and interaction weight has been defined for each coalition scenario based on expert judgment, collecting the responses from the questionnaire. Finally, all the information about intensity and interaction weight among all the potential coalition scenarios were aggregated and normalized in a 0-1 range in order to allow the integration of all the information about hazard, exposure, and risk we will see in the next step in the final multi-hazard interaction score. So, looking at the first resulting output from the multi-hazard interaction assessment phase, in this example, we have the resulting multi-hazard map for the anthropogenic biological hazard. So we can notice that the higher hazard score can be observed in correspondence of the most busy shipping traffic, because it was in the assignation of the interaction weight from the marine expert, it was recognized as the main driver of introduction of non-indigenous species in the area of concern. But we also recognize higher hazard score in the North Adriatic Sea, where relevant ports such as the port of Venice and Trieste are located. If we look at the comparison between the baseline and future scenario, we can recognize a rising hazard score, and this is mainly due to the rising sea temperature that is envisioned for the 2035-2050 scenario. So in this case, we can observe how changes in the climate condition can exacerbate the resulting hazard score. So, but we have this available resulting maps, but how can be used by decision maker and planners? For sure, hazard multi-hazard interaction maps can be used by marine planners and decision makers to implement the Marine Strategy Framework Directive, supporting the assessment of different pressure indicators, such as the evaluation of alteration of physical and chemical parameters, or to evaluate the bottom stress due to the aforementioned pressure. Moving to the second step, we find out the exposure assessment, which allow to identify and select and localize a receptor that can be threatened by the just evaluated pressure. And also in this case, we collected a lot of data from different private and open source data platform in order to characterize the receptor and localize them. According to the receptor were selected, okay, due to the availability of homogeneous data, but also taking into account the requirement of the Marine Strategy Directive. So, as a consequence, we focus as main receptor on the marine environment, so the overall basin as a whole, and then we identify some hotspot target with high environmental and economic values. So we selected the seagrasses meadow, the coral and mud beds, the marine protected area, and finally the aquaculture activities. So looking at the resulting exposure map, we identified that most of the receptors are located along the along coastal area. And basically, we can find out available surface of seagrasses meadow in the Adriatic, in the Italian Adriatic part of the basin. And most of the seagrasses meadows and the coral and mice bed are protected under the protection of marine protected areas. Also, in this case, exposure map allows to identify high environmental and socioeconomic targets that have to be taken into account in the definition of marine plans and management strategies in order to prevent potential losses and damages on these areas. So moving on the third step, we have the vulnerability assessment. This phase allows to evaluate the degree to which the receptor can be adversely affected by the considered multi-hazard interaction. by characterizing the vulnerability pattern through site-specific physical environmental information. Also, this methodological phase is subdivided in three specific operative steps. So we have, first of all, to identify the physical and environmental vulnerability factor, which allow to characterize the vulnerability of our receptor according to the hazard of concern. So for instance, just to provide some example from this table, we selected as a vulnerability factor the typology of the seafloor, the proximity between the marine protected areas considered as a proxy of their connectivity, the Shannon index, and so on. Then we classify and normalize the vulnerability factors in vulnerability classes according to the judgment of a team of environmentalist experts. Basically, most of the environmental vulnerability factors are hazard dependent, are hazard independent, but except for the seabed typology, that is hazard dependent. So we associate a specific vulnerability score to each vulnerability class of the seabed typology factor according to the different hazard that we analyzed in our study. Then, finally, we aggregate all the information, all the vulnerability factor for the hazard considered by applying a multi-criteria decision analysis algorithm that in this case is we apply the probabilistic all function for all the considered hazard. So looking at the resulting output of this assessment phase, we can recognize a quite homogeneous, very high and high vulnerability score across the overall case study and for the vulnerability to the considered hazard. Just to provide an example of the vulnerability to the anthropogenic acute chemical hazard, we can notice a slightly lower values in the Croatian coast, and this is a lower vulnerability score is mainly due to the presence in this area of a relevant number of marine protected areas close to each other, that in this way reduce the vulnerability score. And also on a high biodiversity of the area recognized by the Shannon index vulnerability factors. Alongside the GIS maps, we also summarize the statistics, some the main findings of this assessment phase. And also in this case, we can recognize across the six vulnerability to the linked six hazard, a quite homogeneous vulnerability score in the high and very high classes. Vulnerability maps and statistics represent available support for decision makers and marine planners for the design and implementation of solutions, for instance, for the implementation of natural-based solutions that can support the increase of the resilience of vulnerable targets. We can, for instance, to think about the transplantation of seagrasses or also the implementation, the definition, I mean, of new marine protected area in the area of concern. So looking at the multi-risk assessment of the multi-risk assessment phase, based on the recent definition of the IPCC, we consider the risk as the potential adverse consequence for natural and human system, resulting from the interaction between hazard, vulnerability, and exposure. So we integrate all the information obtained from the previous three steps in order to identify and ranking areas that are risk in the baseline 2000-2050 and future scenario 2035-2050. So looking at the resulting output, in this case we have the comparison bar chart. We can observe that risk generally assume lower values than the hazard ones, since they are multiplied with the vulnerability, which assume a score basically equal to one around the overall case study. However, some trends of hazard are visible, especially if we compare the baseline with the future scenario, where we can recognize a rising hazard score among the, especially among the anthropogenic biological hazard. The risk assessment phase allowed to identify the major risk which contribute to the final overall cumulative impacts in the at the case study level. So moving to the last step of the cumulative impact appraisal, we finally integrate and summarize all the information about the evaluated risk in a cumulative impact index, which allow to represent the cumulative impact for both the considered scenario. In this case, the normalized value assumed by the risk map due to the number of considered risks, so we consider it 6 risks, it's a cumulative impact score that range from 0 to 6. So here are the resulting cumulative impact map for the Adriatic Sea Basin, for the baseline and future scenario. And this map show basically low and moderate cumulative impact score in the range from 0 to 2.5 across the overall case study. And the higher cumulative impact score are mostly focused in the Italian marine coastal shelf, as well as in the central part of the Adriatic Sea. And this is mainly due to the massive shipping traffic, the towing fishing activities taking place along the Italian coast, the Italian side of the Adriatic Sea, but these values are also due to the localization of benthic infrastructure that highly damage the sea floor of the Adriatic Sea. Comparing the baseline with the future scenario 2035-2050, we can recognize a rising cumulative impact score with a shift from the lower classes of cumulative impact from the baseline from the upper classes in the future scenario. And this is due, as we already observed in the previous hazard assessment phase, to the rising sea temperature that is envisioned, that is projected in the 2035-2015 scenario. According to this scenario and parameter, the sea surface temperature, a relevant number of unusually warm events are projected for the future scenario. This output provides an overall picture of the mostly affected area, and they can be used by decision makers and planners to support an efficient cross-sectorial and integrated definition of policies and plans for the Adriatic Sea Basin. As I already introduced, I moved to the slide. Okay, as I already introduced in the first slide, as a final ring of this methodological, of this risk-based methodological approach, we also implement Bayesian belief network technique in order to evaluate the probability of changes in the cumulative impact score against different climate and management scenario. But just to introduce Bayesian belief network, Bayesian belief network are probabilistic graphical models which allow to represent the system component in the definition of variables and their relationship in that are defined according to conditional interdependencies by combining the principle of graph and probability theory. So such kind of technique, methodological approach, I mean, allow to integrate different knowledge domains, expertise, and data source. So in this case, we can integrate GIS-based data and environmental indicators in a unique system, supporting multi-scenario evaluation. So just to focus on the main step of the implementation and training of Bayesian network, we define as a first step the conceptual model to define the structure of the network, identifying the main variable, which are recognized as nodes, the relationship between the different variables that are called arrow in the Bayesian network-based diagram. Then we parametrize the model, defining the states for all the nodes, for all the variables. So there can be interval, Boolean, or labeled classes, states. And then we calculate the prior probability resulting from the data distribution of our output from the previous assessment phase. Then we perform the scenario analysis by setting different evidence. So basically, we set in specific states among the nodes of the network. And then we observe the changes in the posterior probability. Finally, we also perform the sensitivity analysis in order to evaluate how sensitive are the model outcomes, how sensitive is the cumulative impact node to changes in the parents' nodes in the network. So the conceptual model was defined, was trained according to the methodological approach that I just explained. So basically, we recognize as a first level, a first module in the light blue boxes, the pressure that contribute to the different hazards, to the six hazards that I've just introduced in the risk-based methodological framework. So we recognize the anthropogenic, the biological and chemical hazard. Then we have the vulnerability, risk, and finally the cumulative impacts node. We define the different states according to the classification already used in the previous methodological approach, and then we calculate the prior and posterior probability. So once the network is trained, we can move to the scenario analysis. For our objective, we defined four different scenarios. A first one that focuses on the implementation of new marine protected areas, which contribute to reduce the overall vulnerability of the case study. A second scenario, which model the influence of a rising sea temperature on the case study and as a consequence affecting the anthropogenic chronic and chemical acute chemical hazard and biological hazard. And finally, other two scenarios that I'm not going to present you today in the webinar, which simulate the increase of nutrient input in the Adriatic Sea and also the reduce of cumulative impact. So basically it's a scenario which allows to identify which are the required management measures and adaptation strategies required to reduce the overall cumulative impact. So focusing on the first two scenarios, the first one simulate the establishment of new marine protected areas to reinforce the ecological connectivity. So basically we modify the states of the factor related to the marine protected area connectivity according to their distance. So we define this kind of scenario, and then we observe the posterior probability based on this evidence. And what can be recognized is a remarkable reduction of the overall vulnerability to the related hazard, especially if we look at the introduced and destructive technological hazard, we observe a remarkable reduction. But if we look at the resulting, at the changes in the posterior probability of the cumulative impact node, we can observe that, okay, there is an increased probability of lower classes of cumulative impact source, but it's a slight increased probability of lower classes. And this is mainly due to the higher importance of the pressure and hazard component in driving the overall cumulative impact score. Then looking at the second scenario, which simulates an increased sea surface temperature, from the bar chart, we can notice a more evident change for the biological hazard, where the sea surface temperature variation highly contributes to the biological hazard interaction level. But also in this case, if we look at the resulting output, we can observe an increased probability of the overall cumulative impact score, especially around the moderate cumulative impact classes. So in this case, a changes in the temperature can threaten the future cumulative impact scenario. Finally, we also perform the sensitivity analysis of the cumulative impact node to the influence of its parent nodes. modifying one by one the input parameters. So modifying one by one the parents node of the cumulative impact variable, that is the final nodes of our network. And then we observe the changes in the cumulative impact node according to the evidence set to the parents node. So looking at the pressure model that is on the top left of this slide, we can observe that highly changes from the prior to comparing prior probability with the posterior probability is mainly linked to the trolling fishing activities and the dredging activity that mainly contribute to increase the cumulative impact score. So in this case, we can say that cumulative impact score, the cumulative impact is highly sensitive to changes on these two variables. In turn, this output is mirrored, on the hazard module. So we recognize higher changes in the chemical and in the introduced technological hazard and introduced extractive hazard due to the abrasion and smooth terrain sealing of the seabed. And finally, in turn, these two outputs are also linked with the resulting risk. So basically, we can summarize the sensitivity analysis, identifying the human-induced activity due to trolling, fishing, and dredging and extraction from the seabed as the main driver of changes in the cumulative impact score. So just to summarize the main finding from this presentation and from this application and methodological approach, we have seen a multi-risk approach which allowed to integrate different tools, methods, including indicator, GIS, Bayesian network, which acted together as a decision support tools which allow to develop a set of maps, statistics, and basically a wider knowledge base to support the development of science-based policies and management measures for the marine area considering the study. Then we have seen the application of Bayesian Belief Network, which allowed to consider and evaluate a wide spectrum of scenarios and options in order to develop integrated measurement management scheme, which are able on one side to define appropriate and sustainable measure for the use exploitation of the sea, but also on the other side, appropriate conservation and protection measure for the marine environment. But the methodology has also some limitations that are mainly due to the modeling of the dynamic behavior of pressure, hazard, and vulnerability component in the temporal and spatial dimension. So we, in an advanced methodological approach, we should consider the pressure persistence, the cascading effect, and the change in the ecosystem resilience. So in order to face this challenge, we can exploit the potential that is posed by machine learning algorithms, which can support the automatization of time-consuming data processing, and they can, in turn, simplify cumulative impact appraisal and multi-scenario analysis under the integration of different input data, but also different constraints. So that's all. Thank you. Thank you for your attention, and now is the time for questions from the researchers that are connected.
Thank you, Elisa, for the comprehensive presentation. The Q&A session is open. There is already a question from Inger Naslund. I'm sorry if my pronunciation of the name is not correct. The question is, it is not clear if the anthropogenic factors include the fisheries. Can you clarify, Elisa?
So basically, between the anthropogenic pressure, we consider the trolling fishing activities among the pressure that are considered as a whole in the in the hazard related to the anthropogenic extraction and abrasion of the seabed. So, I mean, fisheries activities has been considered in this way in our assessment procedure.
Okay, then there is another question. Does the technique allow, sorry, the question is from Jan Stewart. Does the technique allow for local community input on knowledge regarding impact on biophysical parameters, or is this restricted to natural scientists?
Okay, this is an interesting question that paved the way to introduce some of the key point of the methodological approach that I propose today. So basically, on one side, I think that they can be involved on the first definition of the score and weights that we associate to the vulnerability factors, and also in the definition of the coalition of the interaction weight for the coalition scenario within the multi-hazard interaction assessment phase. But I think that also an interesting way for the involvement is also to tailor the multi-scenario analysis performed through the Bayesian network according to the input and the evidence that can be collected from different perspectives and the involvement of not only from the risk expert and scientists and researchers. So in this way, I mean, we can customize the methodological approach and can tailor it in different level, I mean.
Okay, then there is another question from Alessandro Gianni. I understand you consider dredge fishing, hydraulic dredge, as a major element of concern. Can you confirm this? Do you have specific data? Are you aware such fishing system in Northern Adriatic has been granted the green label by MSC?
So basically, when we perform the sensitivity analysis, what is emerged that is that the cumulative impact node is highly sensitive by the pressure related to the trolling fishing activity and the dredging of sands and gravel of material from the seabed. And this result is also confirmed by other studies that focus on the Adriatic Sea. Recent studies that are linked with other projects dealing with maritime spatial planning in the Adriatic Sea. So, I mean, from resulting up to from the SHAPE and Adriplan project. In this paper, the authors recognize the same pressure as the main driver of cumulative impacts and environmental impacts in the Adriatic Sea basin. So there is a match in the resulting output from the study that I presented today and from other studies.
Okay, thank you. Then another one is if there are not questions from the room, I can continue from people connected online. The next is from Mauricio Cote, or Cote, I don't know. The question is, how can this risk approach can be considered or included in climate change mitigation and adaptation plans for coastal areas?
I mean, okay, thank you for this question. I think that the resulting output of this assessment can be used on one side. It's interesting in this approach because we have a different step. The different steps have different output that can be used in different way by decision makers and planners to define appropriate measure and strategy. So, for instance, for the hazard component, we recognize the main hazard driving changes in the Adriatic Sea, and then we can act in a management perspective, searching to reduce such a kind of activity that lead to higher hazard score. On the other side, we can work on the vulnerability component. As I already suggested, maybe we can increase the surfaces of seagrasses, meadows, that we know basically is a nature-based solution and also a non-regret solution compared with the other gray solution, more costly, more pricey solution that can on one side contribute to increase the resilience of the marine ecosystem, but the sea grasses, for instance, provide multiple ecosystem services, so we can also recognize an economic value of this kind of solution. They can contribute to mitigate the and dissipate the wave energy on the seafloor, so contribute to mitigate the impact posed by potential climate change scenario, I mean.
Okay, now Elisa, a question from my side. What is your feeling about the possibility to transfer this approach, this methodology, also in other areas? Because you mentioned, for example, machine learning algorithm at the end of your presentation that are the engine, are very useful, for example, for also for big data analysis. So maybe this huge amount of data could be easily also processed for other areas beside the Adriatic region that you evaluated. Do you think this will be feasible also for, at different scales, for example, with different resolution? What do you think about that?
Okay, thank you for this question. That it's interesting for introducing two points related to the methodology. First of all, the methodology is flexible, and due to the modular structure that I propose, can be applied, is flexible enough to be applied in different geographical contexts and different marine regions that can be featured by the same or similar environmental traits or by similar condition of multiple pressure. Is flexible also to be expanded. I mean, we can also integrate other pressure and other vulnerability factor according to the availability or more accurate with higher resolution data. And for sure, another potential is the implementation of the methodological approach in a more functional analytical chain, and this process can be done by exploiting the potential posed by big data and the potential posed by machine learning algorithm with the collaboration of other colleagues of the Euro-Mediterranean Center for Climate Change Foundation. We implement this methodological approach in Ofidia, in the workflow of the Ofidia, which allowed to automatize the analytical process and evaluate cumulative impacts in the Southern Adriatic and the Northern Ionian Sea. So basically, we replicate the analysis with different data, with higher resolution, and we implement the methodological approach in a functional operational system. We simplify the pre-processing data phases and the integration of different indicators, and finally, the scenario analysis. So the potential posed by the supercomputing machine learning algorithm and the unprecedented rate of data that are now available from climate model, but also from data provided by satellite monitoring campaign, there is a big potential. So, and I think that is the right way to implement more reliable and effective assessment procedure that can really support decision maker and planner in their hard task of management of the marine areas, I mean.
Okay, thank you. I think we can close this webinar now. Thank you again, Elisa. I don't know if you want to share again your contact. Okay, they are in the slide. So people that want to ask something to Elisa can write to her. I want to give some information about the next CMCC webinar. So next slide, please. Just to to say that the next MCC webinar will be on FAO and the Coronivia Joint Work on Agriculture on February 19 at 12 Central European Time. And last but not least, also for people that were asking through the Q&A session, this webinar today was recorded and it will be available soon through the CMCC website, social channels and the YouTube channel. So I can close and I want to thank you all and have a nice day. Thank you, Elisa, again.
Bye-bye.
Bye.